Today I'm recognized by my name. A few 24 hours ago I was recognized by my number. 2621413. 013, you there? All right, come out so I can see you. I'm gonna hide in the blankets. The room is supposed to be a 6x8, it's a 5x4. The toilet's in there, probably about with your head, and your feet are hanging out of the cell, and you're going, this doesn't make sense. How did I get here? What did you do to get here? People are put in solitary confinement for some of the most remedial things. They can go to the hole for writing a letter. Someone can put you in the hole for writing a letter, threatening letter to you against the staff. You can actually get involved with something that's on the compound and they'll hide you for 6 or 7 months a year. It's no problem there. But what happens when you go behind these bars and you go behind these cells and the double cells and the boxes that they put you in? You lose something. Freedom. It's a valuable asset. Solitary confinement. The first 6 months to a year, you can hear and communicate with everybody. Your toilet's the phone. The way we send a wire is with a ripped piece of a sheet and a pencil so we can get things passed back and forth. Nothing big. Just a battery or something. Run my radio. Or to send a note. Yeah, I know you got candy there, you send me some. You know. But you lose human contact. You lose the small things. Cars to me look like space bubbles. I'm just getting that out there right now. They do. I've been home a year and a half. And what I went to jail for was 2 pills. Just 2. And it took 27 years from me. I was all your age when I went in, about your age when I went in. And it took a great, great swath of my youth and my life going behind these bars. The rat, you talk to him. You talk to the window, you talk to the door, because it's just these 4 walls. In a little bit, I'll tell you about these 4 walls. For right now, we're going to stick with this solitary confinement. Being taken from population to segregation, first off, is an embarrassment. And second of all, you lose everything you work for or you thought you were working for as far as classes were concerned and trying to lower your release date, you know, good behavior checkpoints and whatnot. And so my first trip to the hole was in a place called The Wall. It was here in Virginia, in Lorton, Virginia. The wall was in the Sally Port. If you know what the Sally Port is, it's actually the front of the jail. You go in between where the bus lets go between 2 gates. Well, they had cells in those first Sally Port. They had 25 cells in there, which means there were no windows. There was a 65-foot wall all the way around the facility. They used a golf cart to ride around. Well, you're under that, in that wall. You're literally in the wall. And I did that for about a year and a half. Every 14 days, by law, they had to take me out of there, put me in another cell, and bring me back. So they did that. But I was like Batman when I came out. Couldn't see anything. Couldn't do anything. And it was traumatic. It was real traumatic. But then, my 27 years, I slipped through the system of mental health. I didn't know I had paranoid schizophrenia. I didn't know I had depression, bipolar, and PTSD. But I endured a struggle. I endured a lot of trauma during the course of this. And so what happens is, when you go behind bars and you go into solitary confinement, you lose human contact. You lose personal contact. People don't get letters. You don't get letters, or maybe they hold your mail for 30 days. And they can do anything to you. You don't move when they say move. They can spray you down. You're stuck in the cell. What can you do? All you can do is you be there. These things sound horrific, but they happen. They literally happen. In the 4 years I stayed in solitary confinement, I watched people lose their mind to the point where they had to be hospitalized because they couldn't take care of it. They couldn't maintain the fact that there was no human contact. They couldn't communicate with anybody. communication is so vital in solitary confinement that everybody comes to the door, hey, what's the weather like outside? What's going on? Little things that we take for granted. We go out of our home every day and we get in a on the bus, or we go by way of walking there to get to our destination, school, class, the show, the movies, whatever. You can't do that in solitary confinement. And what happens to the person that's in solitary confinement, you lose track of time. The 4 years went by so fast that I didn't realize I was doing it because I was so used to regimen. I couldn't tell you if it was night or day, other than by the tray they sent me in to eat off. So when I got the tray, I said, it must be dinner, which they serve dinner at lunchtime. And lunchtime and dinner is lunch. You know what I'm saying? They can switch it up. But it's hard when you lose the grasp of reality and are caught up in the system. It's a double standard. When you go behind and get in that 6x8 cell, you're at the mercy of an officer that's running 60 to 90 to 100 cells. One officer. He's in a bubble. You want to take a shower, you want to do whatever, you got to ask permission. In the ADX, your communication is solely on the television. You cannot change the channel. You have to ask for the channel to be changed. When you get mail, it comes over the TV. And you have to be patient with the person that is flipping the pages for you, because if you don't, they just cut the TV off or cut your mail feed off when you're standing there looking stupid. Videotapes of your family is what they allow in ADX. You never touch the tape. Can you play my business over again? You know what I mean? Right here in Lorton, I got locked they had a Supermax down here. And they counted everything from the seeds in the apple to the stem. They wanted that back. Anything you didn't eat, they wanted back. You couldn't flush it down the toilet. They think you're trying to make something. Little things, you become pretty MacGyverish when you're in solitary confinement. You know, you can't have normal amenities like a book, oh, with the pages connected. You know what I mean? The book comes unglued, the glue is taken out of the book. So you get a thing in a bag, and it's the book, but it's 500 pages loose. So you got, okay, I read that one, okay, I'm gonna read this. The glue is there. They look at the glue, the staples, all that level. Everything you get that comes in that cell is clear. Soap, deodorant, toothpaste, toothbrush, comb, and you got it. It's all clear. You can't hide it. And they ask you when they come to set, they shake your cell down, see what you've made out of soap, see what you've made out of different things they bring to them. They might not have got the all aluminum foil off the juice container they sent you. They'll come in, where's the aluminum foil at? What'd you make, the burner or what? You know. It's hard. When you look back, I think about me cooking coffee over the toilet in a milk carton with a donut. And that was my day. Okay, I get my coffee. I load up on the coffee at breakfast time, put it in milk cartons. Then I heat it up because I was able to smoke. That was when we were able to smoke in prison. But that was my world. I drink coffee and try to communicate with the other guys on that range. But you never see him. We could talk for years. We could be in there for years and never. He could walk by me and I couldn't tell you it was him. And vice versa. Because it's just you're there so long. Your communication skills are dampened and hardened and abused. You can't even communicate with a normal group of people because you're so lost in what you used to do as far as protecting yourself mentally. You lock in and then now you're sitting there talking to yourself and you're answering yourself. You're like, hey, did that make sense? Yeah, that made sense. We did that. And sometimes you never come back. In a lot of cases, they never come back. Case in point, one of my best friends did 7 years in solitary confinement. And if it weren't for this program that I was in when I left prison last year, I don't think he'd make it. He couldn't communicate. He would stand in the corner by himself, hold a verbal of audible conversation, and no one's there. They answer it, repeat it, say it over again, and no one's there. And for myself, I went in. The first lockdown I went to was at Lorton in South Court, like I said. It was a concrete slab to sleep on and a hole in the floor to use the bathroom. And when I think about that you don't even treat your animal that way. You know what I mean? It's just the way they had it set up. So, and everything that comes in, they want it back. The metal tray, at that time they were serving metal trays. They were genius, just handing out knives, basically. Because the tray didn't come back, what it was next, it was a shame. So, things took their turn for me, and I want to say 36, 37, well actually, 4 years ago, 4.5 years ago, whereby I decided I wouldn't drink or drug or use any mind-altering substances. And what I found that when I went to that I had some serious mental health issues that were not being addressed. Through the help of RSC, which is the Reentry Sanction Center in DC, I was diagnosed with paranoid schizophrenia, schizoaffective, bipolar, depression, and there's a couple more, I just can't remember them all right now. But I was not medicated and I didn't have any counseling to walk through these issues. A good thing to do for me, what I had to do, and you may find this helpful for yourself, is keep a journal daily. At the end of the day, when everybody's gone anyway, it doesn't have to be a lot, just a thought. You put it in a book. Go back 30 days and read it. I guarantee you'll be amused to what you wrote. You'll be truly amused at what you wrote. Solitary confinement steals your liberty. It steals your pride, your dignity, and all the things that are associated with that. You don't feel as though you're good enough to be around people or communicate to them when you come out. So most cases, your eyes are down, and you're walking with your head up and down and walking around in a world that you created because of the solitary confinement. And it takes a lot of medication to break that monotony and bring you back into reality that people don't act like that, or people don't do that, because you've been taken off the grid for so long. You're used to the 6x8 and somebody beating on you every day. Take a shower for what? I'm the only one in here. There's nobody gonna bother me. You know, go to the rec yard. The rec yard's a cement box. See the room we're standing in? The room we're standing in would be six boxes, concrete boxes with concertine and wire over the top of them. Like, I can actually scale a flat concrete wall, but this is where you're at. And that constitutes as your 23 and a half. A lot of prisons don't get that. The 23 and 1 hour out. Might take a week before you get out, depending on how many people are on the range for that 1 hour. And if the guy's not lazy and doesn't want to, you know what I'm saying? If the guy's lazy and he doesn't want to do the run, he'll write it down in the book like he did the run and got all his people done, then he's gone. You can't argue with him, he's gone. You don't even know when he left because you don't know what time of day it is. The cell that you're in has a window that's unseeable. You can't even look through it to see what's out in the rec yard. Or they take these mats and put them up against the wall to hide all the windows so that you can't see out. Or they can't see in. It's very guarded. Both prisons, the shoe is very guarded. They only clean up their act when some staff member or somebody from the organization comes down and says, we want to see your cell. Mm-hmm. Then they push out the guys that they were nonviolent, whatever, remedial charges from them, you know, against them. They put them out of there. The guys at a harder court there, see, he's supposed to be here. He's supposed to be, see how he's supposed to be here? And they can justify it. I went to the whole, they had a riot in Lorton. Maybe you were in elementary school then, when that happened. they had a riot. I got caught up in the riot, ended up in Walla Walla, Washington, in Colorado. And in my trans, I ended up in the ADX. They bring the shower to your door. Your rec yard is in your cell. Your communication is the TV on the wall, is your mail, is your post office, your doctor, your lawyer, your family, the TV is that. Forget what's going, what time of day it is. You don't know. You don't know if it's day or night because you're in artificial sunlight in the cell. And in some cases, you can't even control the light. You have to ask for it to be turned off or on because it has wires in it. And they don't want you with the wires. Because you know they think you can get that wire off the wall. Okay? Go figure. Well, the other part to this is this. If you can conceive being in a 6x8 cell, 365 days a year, 24 hours a day, it's an awesome task to take. Especially when you've done nothing to get there. I went into hole over a cigarette and ended up doing almost 40 years in the hole because it was constipated. A pack of cigarettes in solitary confinement was $500. $500 for a pack of cigarettes. You can get anything in there. The trustees, they walk around, they connect you to the outside. That's your world. My post office was a battery hooked to a sheet, a shredder sheet, and I could sling it down the hall to one cell on the other side of the tier, and then he'd sling it over to the next cell for me, and that's how we communicated. Did you see that? Did you get this? You got a magazine, whatever, and this is how we communicated. Then there are points. When you're in a cell, that's within a cell, that's within a cell. Literally, it's a box on top of a box on top of a box. Window behind you, but it's actually a tier that the staff walk on and walk around the cells. And if you're cutting up in your cell, just drop a little, spray a little mace in there, you'll be all right. You know, not how half the people on a tier, but that's, they don't care about that. They want order. That's their way of gaining order. And some, you know, their power struggle. When I went to Lewisburg, and you got guys been under the ground for 25 years. Don't know what normal, it'll never be normal again. There's no way they can be, it takes so much. One guy that had 7 years, it took the whole 36 months I was there to bring him to the point where he could actually sit in a group and hold a conversation about what has happened to him. Because we couldn't even get his name out of him when we started. We needed all that. Things are so small. For me now, coming outside, keys for instance, I just got my first set in 30 years, then to my own room. So you know what I do? I get up in the morning, know I need a key, but forget I got a key, and then walk out the house. And when the door shuts behind me, go, guess what? I don't have any keys. I'm not in prison anymore. So you have to really get back your focus. Little things, it's just little things you forget. I need a shirt and tie. Okay, I love this one. Go to wash clothes. I'm used to taking everything and throw it in the wash machine and get it washed. See? It's washing. Not realizing the colors and the lights have to be separated. You know, and so I'm learning. You know, I'm learning how to cook. Everything is new to me. The things that you guys take for granted is just new to me. Starbucks on every corner is great. There's more Starbucks now than our liquor stores. It's great. Love coffee. The cars all look, I couldn't tell you one make or model of the cars from the next. Because they all like space bubbles. And they zoom pretty fast. Just going in the grocery store for me is an overwhelming experience. I could stand in the aisle and go, wow, this is cool. I can get all this stuff in here. You know, they opened a new Kmart, a Walmart up the street from me. I think I spent an hour and a half and didn't get out of 3 hours. I'm trying to figure out, okay, what does that do? Oh, wow, that does that too. You can do that with that? Okay. Just little, y'all would be overwhelmed at how small things, you know, ink pens that, you know, are actually more than 3 inches long and not rubber. Everything you get is clear. Everything is, you know what I'm saying, to write with, to do whatever. It's you can't stab anybody with it because it's rubber. The pencil is rubber. And you just think differently. You think, when the guards don't hit you, the guards on the line, the man's on the line, you hear that, you turn to play with yourself, go back and sit down. You might be holding a conversation. And they see the wire. You like to communicate, they see the wire, they send a book. And he might help you every now and then. What you want from them? A book? Okay, I'll get it for you. There's a few good officers in there. I'm not saying they're all bad. But solitary confinement is a travesty. It should never happen. There are some people that can't be in the population. I understand that. But solitary confinement is not the way to do it. It's not the way to begin. It's not the way to end. You lose your mind, your trust of people, your trust in your dignity. You got a camera on you 24 hours a day in your cell. Every time you do this, they know about it. Every time you cough, they know about it. When you are distracted or you try to distract the officer so the other guy can send a wire the other way, whatever, they know about it because the cameras are all over the aisle and in the cell itself. The only thing they have to put them in is the shower. I guess, I don't know, I'll figure that one out yet. They'll figure out some way to do it. Then the phone calls, solitary confinement, wow. Phone call comes on TV, and you just kind of, yeah, it's impersonal. It's taking the humanistic side of it out. Because basically you're looking at a tape of a phone call that they had for you. You answered in your mind, yeah, I would did that differently. Yeah. So you write a letter. Your letter might get out. Because it goes to staff. You can't even seal a letter in the Federal Bureau of Prisons. You have to leave it open. So your intimate secrets or anything you want to say to a loved one is divulged to that staff member that handles your mail. Anything political, analytical, or they think it's political or analytical, they'll come see you about it. What did you mean by this? What do you mean what I mean by that? That's just a letter. I'm sending a letter. You know, and the guys didn't have ink. They wipe with urine. They write a letter with urine. They take it, sit on the light, and the letter will pop up. And that sounds really far-fetched, but it's fact. That's the fact. And a lot of times they try to send letters out of prison with these like that. And that's how they trap a bunch of guys in California when I was out there. Because that's how they gain business from it was in the penal system. The phone, robbery on its best day. $10, 5 minutes. That's beastly. So I didn't call nobody. I need that $10 to put in my commissary. Because what they're feeding is roadkill half the time. And I look at it now, we go in a store or a restaurant to get a burger or get something to eat. Don't leave that. That's good food. You know how people give me a doggy bag or whatever. You put all that in the air, you can eat that later. You know, I have a different look on being wasteful. I'm not wasteful. You know, I'm very frugal. So right now my room's like, I have a room and it's about a little bigger than two cells, you know what I mean? But it's mine, and the first time I had keys to my own room in 30 plus years. And then after that, clothes. I got suits and ties and things like that. I didn't have nothing. A year and a half ago, last March, not this March past, the March before this, I've been home almost 2 years now. So, I had a lot of different problems, you know, coming home and communing with family. Oh, by the way, I went through foster care as a kid. And I guess it didn't help make things matter as far as PTSD was concerned. But I just met my whole family November of last year. November of last year. So, we had a little party, 150 people showed up. I'm thinking it's for them. They're all there to see me, they're all family members. So now I have a call list I have to make every day to call these people I'm just getting to meet. And then they're asking me my advice on things. I'm going, oh, I don't know. You tell officer, you know? Or standing up, this is a killer. At 4 o'clock, there's a stand-up count. At 4 o'clock, I would get up and stand up. My mom would ask me, what are you doing? I said, it's the 4 o'clock count. I'm sorry, you know, it chimed off in my head. It's time for me to stand up. That's how long I was incarcerated. I didn't have to basically, I spent the first 60 days home with my aunt, where they had to debrief. They don't do that out there. You can't wear that. You can't eat that. You know what I mean? It was a challenge going to learn how to be normal and act normal in society. Since coming home, I've become a certified peer specialist. I'm a RAP certified, and I'm NAMI certified for mental health. And I'm a council member for the board of, the council for the Department of Behavioral Health in Washington, D.C. I'm a council member on the advocacy committee. You could have told me. But one of the things that helped me was being able to help some other people. David, I'll just say his name is Mr. Davis. He had done 7 years in solitary confinement, so him and I, we could communicate a little better than everybody else in the unit because I knew what he was going through because I went through it myself. I was a little more open-minded when I came out to communicate to other people. He hadn't talked to anybody in 7 years. You know, I mean, his mother, his father, his daughter, anything, you know, for 7 years he hadn't talked to anybody. So all his conversations were internal. All my conversations were internal until we met. And in prison, they have a thing called an ICP, it's the Inmate Companion Program. And you're assigned an inmate, and that inmate is there to assist you on your daily functions. When I came out of my cocoon shell after 30-something years in and out of the prison, bouncing my head up against the bricks, and coming back. Oh, by the way, I didn't catch any new charges until 2010. I went back in and out about 10 or 12 times, but I didn't have any new charges. I just had mental health issues. My behavior wasn't going the way it was supposed to. That's because I was afraid to believe or put my trust in the system. No, I didn't trust the police officer to help me. I didn't trust the PO. I didn't trust a counselor, a case manager, a psychiatrist, or psychologist. I didn't trust them because they left me in that cell. They didn't come and reach for me while I was in that cell. So what do they want now? That's how I felt. But today, my case manager, my parole officer, they throw me out of her office every time I go there. What are you here for? Why are you here? Well, it's Tuesday. I'm supposed to be here. I need to see you. You're not doing anything wrong. You need to leave. All right, I'll see you later. Just call me. Okay. That's cool. But it took me 10 or 12 tries to get this right. Now, her staff has asked me to do classes with their returning citizens so that they can better understand what kept me grounded. Today I do NAAA and I'm also I keep that up front. I keep what took me out of the running up front. Okay. And what I look at when I see all these young faces in here, prison is the robbery of your freedom. There is no greater consequence than losing your freedom. You see, these four walls do all but call to attention my plight. There are no real windows to look through to gain a new sight or to envision a future that is bright. So I sit down at my easel, which is 8.5 by 11. I can now hatch out a new piece of heaven. I can travel the oceans and all 7 seas, pick up cockle shells and chase bumblebees. Now as I respectfully remember what caused me to fall, I grab my wits to go down the hall to make a call, grabbing the world by the balls, never to return.